Right. Well, good morning, everyone. Welcome to Calvary Chapel Lemon Grove. We're glad you could join us this morning. Anybody use a little peace this morning? Right. Right. Well, you came to the right place. So we're going to open up in a word of prayer. Then Tony and Karen are going to lead us in song, and we'll see what God has for us today. So let's pray, shall we? Father, we love you and we thank you for this morning. And we thank you, Lord, for this place where we can come and just be apart from the rest of the world for a brief season. A time we can come and learn more about you and draw closer to you and sing your praises, worship you in spirit and truth. And that's what we desire to do today. So now, Lord, we pray, set our hearts free from the cares of the day, and fill us to overflowing with your Spirit. And may your Spirit overflow from us onto the people around us. We love you, Lord. We thank you for this morning. Bless these, your people. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder? Who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you should bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be saved. Jesus, I sing for all that, all you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. That you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh Jesus, I sing for all that, all you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of all kings. Who rules the nations with truth and justice? Who shines the sun in all of its brilliance? The King of glory, the King of all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you should take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh Jesus, I sing for all that, all you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. then you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life that I would be set free. Oh Jesus, I sing for all that, all you've done for me.
You're perfect in all of your ways. Aren't you glad you're loved by the Father this morning?
Yes.
Despite going through horrific earthquakes or hurricanes, recent pandemics or riots, or even going through an election, God is still on the throne. He's still King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And we're here to praise Him this morning. Thank God I never fail, not fail me now, won't fail me now, walking in the way. Thank God I never lay, working all things out, working all things out. Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. My heart is heavy for all my days. Yes, I will for all my days. Yes, I will. I can count on one thing. Same God that never fails, not fails.
Is our God.
how great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And oh, we'll see how great is our God. Age to age, he says, time is in his hands, beginning and the end, beginning and the end. The God in three in one, Father, Spirit, Son, Lion and the Lamb, Lion and the Lamb. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. Oh, see how great is our God. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. Oh, see how great is our God. Name above all names, worthy of our praise, my heart will sing with praise, is our God.
That we can't help but serve a mighty God like you, Father God. Help us to look upward, Father, instead of a horizontally, Lord, on you, Lord Jesus, that has all things. And Lord, help us to be anxious for nothing, but trust in you, from which comes our help. It's in your name we pray.
Take a minute to greet each other, elbow bumps.
Well, good morning again, everyone. I guess it's officially fall, right? With the weather and the cooler temperatures and all that kind of stuff.
Yay!
Yeah, I know, fall's my favorite season out of the year, I think. Just want to welcome you once again to Calvary Chapel Lemon Grove, and thank you for coming. It's good to see you all. I have a couple of announcements for you. Let's see. First of all, the ladies are going to continue their study tomorrow evening. 6:30, ladies, if you're available, and come on out. God is blessing that study greatly. So did you have anything you wanted to share?
Well, this week, chapter 6 is taking us to learning about giving and praying and fasting, so it's really... it's a good chapter, and I've learned a lot. I've learned some new things, so come on out, and we'll talk about it.
it's a very timely teaching, too, about fasting and prayer, and we're going to talk a little bit more about that as we go through the study today. Speaking of fasting and prayer, Calvary Chapel Chino Hills is, they're going to do a special prayer service. It's actually going to be one that they're doing in conjunction with other churches and organizations throughout the country and throughout the world. It's going to be this evening at 5 o'clock, if I remember correctly. And so if you have the time and the inclination, I would commend that to you, because God can do mighty things, you know, when we get on our knees and we, if you love the country, this is a good time to be praying for it, right? So this evening, 5 o'clock, Calvary Chapel, Chino Hills website. I'm not sure what, I think it's calvaryCCH.org is their website. Let's see, what else? Oh yes, next Sunday is Collection Sunday for Operation Christmas Child. And you all know how we feel about that particular ministry. What a wonder it is. Frank, were you able to find anything?
I might have one.
Okay. All right, so we're going to show a little Operation Christmas Child video.
I'm 11 years old, and I really like drawing, playing with my sister, and I have a gigantic dog, Elvis, riding a go-kart. This is Thornhill Ranch. I have 9 great goats, 2 cows, 1 turkey, 2 pins of quail. Sam lives in Stillwell. I live in Ada, so it's about like a 2-hour drive. So, 3 or 4 years ago, we just moved here, and our church was packing Operation Christmas Child shoeboxes. As a family, we packed 3 of them. We sent them to my grandmother, and she and my grandpa presented it to their church, got their whole church started. This lady in their church told her grandson about it, Sam, and then a bunch of other towns and other churches around them in their area. Ava, she's Jane's granddaughter, and I guess we started a friendly competition. He's been trying to get the same amount or more as me. So far, I've beat him. Last year, we tied. I did 126 boxes, but then she got some in after the due date, and she won. This year, I have a goal of packing 150 shoe boxes. Well, this year, I have a goal of packing 150 to 200 shoe boxes. Fine, and I'll get the biggest number I can think of. Huh, well, I'm just gonna order more shoeboxes then. I make flower fairy dolls out of floral wire, embroidered floss, and flowers. We're selling these to put the items for a shoebox, and then to help with shipping. I make necklaces. I actually drill into rocks, and then I wire around them. And I make rock necklaces, and I sell them to finance my shoeboxes. I think it's important to put quality items in a shoebox. Yeah, I do go shopping about once a month. I like to put sewing kits in them, because I love sewing. Packing it full of toys and things that I think are really cool that I really want. I try to get a t-shirt and a pair of socks in each box. In some boxes, I actually put a pair of sunglasses in. The thing that they like the most is something they can put on immediately. Anybody can start. I started by packing 4 shoeboxes. You can pack just one, or you can pack 100. It's up to you. Where one person packs a box, and then another, and another, it keeps multiplying. And as more people pack the boxes, more people are receiving the boxes. When they get a box, they hear about Jesus, and hopefully they'll get saved. I encourage you to pack a shoebox.
That's pretty cool, isn't it?
Yeah.
We still have a few empty boxes, don't we?
Yeah, we have plenty of the cardboard and the plastic ones left if anybody wants to pack a box. Yeah.
If you guys want some, we'll have them available after the service. And just bear in mind, we need them back by next Sunday, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And then we'll take them to the collection center, and they'll be on their way. And so many kids.
We'll be blessed.
might be the first present some of them ever got. Well, I didn't plan to do that. Michael, why don't you come on up and we're going to read, Michael's going to read Psalm 43 for you.
Psalm 43. Vindicate me, O God, and plead my cause against an ungodly nation. O, deliver me from the deceitful and unjust man, for you are the God of my strength. Why do you cast me off? Why do I go mourning because of the oppression of the enemy? O, send out your light and your truth. Let them lead me. Let them bring me to your holy hill and to your tabernacle. Then I will go to the altar of God, to God my exceeding joy, and on the harp I will praise you, O God, my God. Why are you cast down, O my soul, and why are you disquieted within me? Hope in God, for I shall yet praise him, the help of my countenance and my God.
Very good. Well, I think that's a pretty relevant message for this morning. So, now the worship team's going to play one more song, and if you would like to offer tithes and offerings to support the Lord's work here, you can just drop them in the agape box in the hallway. God bless you.
All creation I sing praise to the King of Kings.
start we're off to this morning. You will be pleased to know that I have successfully resisted the urge to make my whole message this morning about the election. But I do have something that the Lord put on my heart about that. So before we get into the message on 1 Corinthians chapter 9, I do want to share this with you. And the scripture that I'm going to be reading is in Psalm 73. So if you want to follow along, you're more than welcome to do that. In fact, you're highly encouraged to do that. When things don't necessarily go the way we're hoping they will, you know, we can tend to get discouraged. We can tend to get depressed or, you know, just worried about the way things are drifting. But this kind of puts it all in perspective, I think. When you go through Psalm 73, it says, "Truly God is good to Israel, to such as are pure in heart. But as for me, my feet had almost stumbled. My steps had nearly slipped, for I was envious of the boastful when I saw the prosperity of the wicked. For there are no pangs in their death, but their strength is firm. They are not in trouble as other men, nor are they plagued like other men. Therefore, pride serves as their necklace. Violence covers them like a garment. Their eyes bulge with abundance. They have more than heart could wish. They scoff and speak wickedly concerning oppression. They speak loftily. They set their mouth against the heavens, and their tongue walks through the earth. Therefore, his people return here, and waters of a full cup are drained by them. And they say, 'How does God know? And is there knowledge in the Most High?' Behold, these are the ungodly, who are always at ease. They increase in riches. Surely I have cleansed my heart in vain and washed my hands in innocence, for all day long I have been plagued and chastened every morning. If I had said, 'I will speak thus,' behold, I would have been untrue to the generation of your children. When I thought how to understand this, it was too painful for me." So Asaph, the psalmist who wrote this particular psalm, is in a place of discouragement and despair. But then comes verse 16. He thinks at first that people are kind of getting away with things, maybe just getting away with things. It seems like the people who are doing evil things are being blessed and prospering. But in verse 16 it says, "When I thought how to understand this, it was too painful for me. Until I went into the sanctuary of God, then I understood their end." It's not about the here, it's about the hereafter. "Surely you have set them in slippery places. You cast them down to destruction. Oh, how they are brought to desolation as in a moment. They are utterly consumed with terrors, as a dream when one awakes. So, Lord, when you awake, you shall despise their image. Thus my heart was grieved, and I was vexed in my mind. I was so foolish and ignorant, I was like a beast before you. Nevertheless, I am continually with you." This is the good news for us. "You hold me by my right hand. You will guide me with your counsel, and afterwards receive me to glory. Whom have I in heaven but you? And there is none upon earth that I desire beside you. My flesh and my heart fail, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever. For indeed, those who are far from you shall perish. You have destroyed all those who desert you for harlotry. But it is good for me to draw near to God. I have put my trust in the Lord God, that I may declare all your works." I think that's a pretty timely message for today. And now we're going to go through 1 Corinthians chapter 9. And if you would please, if you're able, stand with me. We're going to read through 1 Corinthians chapter 9 responsibly. I'll read the first and the odd-numbered verses, and you all can read the even-numbered verses. They'll be up on the screen. And we are going to be reading using the New King James Version. So we'll do 1 Corinthians chapter 9. Am I not an apostle? Am I not free? Have I not seen Jesus Christ our Lord? Are you not my work in the Lord?
If I am not an apostle to others, yet thou hast signed to you, for you are sealed on my apostleship in the Lord.
My defense to those who examine me is this.
Do we have no right to eat and drink?
Do we have no right to take along a believing wife, as do also the other apostles, the brothers of the Lord and Cephas? Whoever goes to war at his own expense, who plants a vineyard and does not eat of its fruit, or who tends a flock and does not drink of the milk of the flock? For it is written in the law of Moses, you shall not muzzle an ox while it treads out the grain. Is it oxen God is concerned about? If we have sown spiritual things for you, is it a great thing if we reap your material things? Do you not know that those who minister the holy things eat of the things of the temple, and those who serve at the altar partake of the offerings of the altar?
Even so, the Lord has commanded that those who preach the gospel should live from the gospel.
But I have used none of these things, nor have I written these things that it should be done so to me. For it would be better for me to die than that anyone should make my boasting void.
For if I preach the gospel, I am not able to do so. For the necessity is laid upon me. Yes, woe is me if I do not preach the gospel.
For if I do this willingly, I have a reward. But if against my will, I have been entrusted with a stewardship.
What is my reward then? That when I preach the gospel, I may present the gospel of Christ without charge.
For though I am free from all men, I have made myself a servant to all, that I might win the more. To those who are without law, as without law, not being without law toward God, but under law toward Christ, that I might win those who are without law. Now this I do for the gospel's sake, that I may be partaker of it with you.
Do you not know that those who run their race all run, but one receives the prize, run in such a way that you may obtain it?
And everyone who competes for the prize is temperate in all things. Now they do it to obtain a perishable crown, but we for an imperishable crown. But I discipline my body and bring it into subjection, lest when I have preached to others, I myself should become disqualified. Amen. You may be seated. So you remember last week we went through chapter 8. And in that chapter, Paul exhorted the Corinthian believers to lay down their liberty so that others wouldn't stumble. And here in chapter 9, Paul is going to use himself as an example to explain this. You know, I could do a lot of things that I don't do. The reason that I don't do them is that I don't want to be an offense to a weaker brother or sister. I don't want to destroy their relationship with God because of my liberty in Christ. Essentially, that's what Paul is saying to the Corinthians. He's telling them that they should be careful, very careful, in exercising their own freedom in Christ. That they would not use it in a way that, you know, it could become a stumbling block to a weaker believer. And now as he continues this line of thought, this argument, he's going to give an example from his own life. Being an apostle, he could make many demands as an apostle. He had the right to do so. But he refuses to make those demands because he doesn't want to cause offense to anyone. So as he's getting into this apostleship now, and his rights as an apostle, he's showing from his own personal experience how he puts into practice the principle that he has just sought to teach them in chapter 8. And that principle is this: yes, you have liberty. We do. You have the rights. But you don't always have to insist on your rights or exercise your liberty, especially if it's going to hurt someone else. The law that governs you, the law that governs me, it's the law of love. My love for my brethren in Christ, especially those who might be weaker in the faith. My love for them is the law that governs my activities, not whether it is right or wrong. So Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 1, am I not an apostle? Am I not free? That is, free to do whatever I want as an apostle. Have I not seen Jesus Christ our Lord? Are you not my work in the Lord? So the first thing he uses as a sign of his apostleship is that he had seen Christ the Lord. And one of the requirements to be considered an apostle in the early church was the ability to bear witness to the resurrection of Jesus Christ. By being an eyewitness, you had to be an eyewitness of his resurrection. That was a requirement for being an apostle. There are people within the church today who want to claim the mantle, the authority of apostleship. From a New Testament standpoint, though, that would be a difficult claim for them to make, because one of the requirements was the ability to bear eyewitness testimony of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Now, Paul declares that he saw Jesus. He also refers to their changed lives as proof of his apostleship. He said they are his epistles of commendation, known and read by all men. Verse 2, if I am not an apostle to others, yet doubtless I am to you, for you are the seal or the certification of my apostleship in the Lord. So he's saying the fruit of the ministry, the proof of my ministry among you, is the fact that you are in the Lord. You are the seal of my apostleship. Verse 3, my defense to those who examine me is this. He's saying, this is my defense to those who would cross-examine me. He's using a couple of legal terms in Greek. Evidently, the divisions in Corinth got them to the place where they said, well, we are of Apollos. And as they did in many places, they began to challenge Paul's claim as an apostle. Have you ever had anybody do that to you? Have you ever had anybody say, on what authority are you telling me these things? It happens. So, Paul said, I am an apostle, not by man's will, but by God's will. But they challenged his claim. And they said, oh, he says he's an apostle, but he's not really an apostle. So they were challenging his apostleship. An apostle is one who was sent out as sort of a spiritual statesman. Paul had been sent to the Corinthians to bring them to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, and to disciple and to develop them as he labored among them. Verse 4, do we have no right to eat and drink? Do we have no right to take along a believing wife, as do also the other apostles, the brothers of the Lord, and Cephas? Or is it only Barnabas and I who have no right to refrain from working? In these first six verses, Paul says, because we are apostles, we have the right to be supported financially, as are James, Jude, Peter, and the other apostles. That's Cephas's Peter. We don't have to work. We have the power to not work as an apostle. For those who preach the gospel have every right to live by the gospel. Verse 7 begins, whoever goes to war at his own expense
So Paul says, in addition to our apostleship, human logic dictates that we be supported. If you go to war, the government provides for you. Those of you who have served in the armed forces know that. You don't go out and buy your own gun or your own ammunition. You don't buy your equipment. Those things are provided for you. I didn't have to buy my own aircraft, which is a good thing because the one I flew in, they cost $350 million apiece. So Paul said, who goes to war and pays his own expenses? Verse 7 continues, who plants a vineyard and does not eat of its fruit? Or who tends a flock and does not drink of the milk of the flock? Not only are military personnel provided for, but the farmer and the shepherd are also allowed to eat of the fruit of their own labor. And now Paul is going to provide a scriptural basis for his premise. Verse 8, do I say these things as a mere man? Or does not the law say the same also? Am I just spouting off as a man? Or does the Bible actually confirm this? Verse 9, for it is written in the law of Moses, you shall not muzzle an ox while it treads out the grain. Is it oxen God is concerned about? Well, Deuteronomy chapter 25, verse 4 says just that. You shall not muzzle an ox while it treads out the grain. So that was a part of the law. The ox that treaded down the grain, you weren't to put a muzzle on him while he did so. It's pretty straightforward. As he was going through, pulling the plows and all, and he could eat as he went through. You weren't to muzzle his mouth because he was laboring. He was working. Paul asked, is God more interested in oxen than he is in men? Paul will use this same Old Testament reference again in 1 Timothy chapter 5, verse 17, when he tells his young protege that elders should be counted worthy of double honor. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 10 says, or does he say it altogether for our sakes? For our sakes, no doubt, this is written, that he who plows should plow in hope, and he who threshes in hope should be partaker of his hope. So we've talked about hope before, right? Do you remember the definition? Well, hope is the absolute expectation of coming good. The one who plows away in ministry should expect good things to come his or her way. It would be cruel to starve those who are providing and preparing your food. To do so would take away all their hope. It makes them feel abused and unappreciated. Verse 11, if we have sown spiritual things for you, is it a great thing if we reap your material things? Paul makes it plain here that it is right for the spiritual work of God's ministers to be repaid with the material support of the people to whom they minister. Verse 12, if others are partakers of this right over you, are we not even more? Nevertheless, we have not used this right, but endure all things, lest we hinder the gospel of Christ. Paul says, it's already your custom to support other ministers. So why would it be unusual for you to support us? It wasn't that the Corinthian Christians refused to support anyone in ministry. Paul says others are partakers of this right. The problem with the believers in Corinth was that they refused to support Paul and thought less of him because he did not receive it. Just as strongly as Paul affirms his right to be supported by the people to whom he ministers, he also affirms his right not to use that right if it might hinder the gospel of Christ for him to do so. This gives us a glimpse into Paul's real heart. Whether he was paid or not paid, it didn't matter to him. What mattered was the work of the gospel. Was it more effective for the gospel if Paul should receive support? Then he would receive it.
Was it more effective for the gospel if Paul should work to support himself? Then he would do that. We all know Paul had a successful career as a tent maker. And I'll bet that the tents that he made were of exquisite craftsmanship. What mattered to Paul was that the gospel should not be hindered in any way. That's what was important to him. Verse 13, do you not know that those who minister the holy things eat of the things of the temple, and those who serve at the altar partake of the offerings of the altar? So you remember that the priests who offered the sacrifices, they got a certain portion of the meat. They got a certain portion of the flour, the other things that people would bring as sacrifices to the Lord. The priests got a share of those things. They lived by those things that were brought in. It was part of their heritage from the Lord. Verse 14, even so, the Lord has commanded that those who preach the gospel should live from the gospel. Where has the Lord commanded that those who preach the gospel should live from the gospel? We do not have a record of Jesus speaking those specific words, but he clearly states the principle in a couple of places. Matthew chapter 10, verse 9 says, provide neither gold nor silver nor copper in your money belts, nor bag for your journey, nor two tunics, nor sandals, nor staffs, for a worker is worthy of his food. And in Luke chapter 10, verse 8, we read, whatever city you enter and they receive you, eat such things as are set before you. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 15. But I have used none of these things, nor have I written these things that it should be done so to me. For it would be better for me to die than that anyone should make my boasting void. Paul said, yes, I have every right, but I'm not exercising it. I'd rather be dead than to take a penny from you. Why did Paul have this attitude? Because, unfortunately, in Paul's day, as in the present day, there are many ministers that abuse this right. Many ministries constantly seek gimmicks, methods, and ways of extracting more money from the people. If you ever get on some of these evangelists' mailing lists, you'll discover just how vivid their imaginations are, and all the gimmicks they use to get you to send in your support for their ministries. If you go to their services, you'll be exposed to their inventive gimmickry. Oh, the Lord has revealed to me that there are 10 people here today who are going to give $1,000 each for this ministry. Or the Lord has revealed to me that there are 50 people here who are going to give $500. That is not so, to put it mildly. That is gimmickry. That is deception. That is fleecing the flock. And that is terrible. And because of such shenanigans, many people have been turned away from the gospel of Jesus Christ. And they say, all you want is your money, is my money. Unfortunately, that's true in many places. I may have shared this with you before, and I don't commend this type of experience to you, but when we were living in Honolulu, one of the more famous televangelists came and held a crusade there. It was Benny Hinn, for those who are wondering. And so I decided to go to the crusade just to see for myself, without the filter of what other people think about what he's saying. I wanted to hear it for myself. And what I saw boggled my mind. They were at the Blaisdell Center there in Honolulu, and there were thousands of people there. And the quality of your seat was directly determined by how much money you had given to support their ministry. The more you gave, the better your seat was. So, of course, I hadn't given a dime, so I was up in the top corner of the arena. You know, the Bob Uecker seats up there in the top. And I tell you, at one point in the service, which went on far too long, I might add, It's like a 3 or 4 hour long service. Maybe I shouldn't call it a service, an event. And at one point, Benny Hinn starts looking out at the people in the audience, and he says, I can feel someone over here getting healed of cancer. And I can feel someone over there getting healed of heart disease. And I can feel someone over here getting healed of leukemia. And I can heal someone over here getting their finances healed. Well, there's no proof for anything that he was claiming. No proof whatsoever. That's why he was making those claims, because nobody could disprove him. And then, after he did that for a while, he said, okay, we're going to do an invitation now. And if you have been healed in any way during this service, I want you to come up to this platform. And so, as he gave this invitation, people started coming up to the platform. And he said something that I have never forgotten and found chilling. He said, if you don't come up to this platform, if you've been healed and you don't come up to this platform right now, God may just take away the healing that he gave you. And when he said that, I got up and walked out because I was about to start screaming that he was a false prophet. And there were plenty of his little private security guards there, and I just decided that it was time for me to leave rather than to disrupt what he was doing. Fleecing the flock. Misrepresents the character and the nature of God. What kind of a God would he be if he just played carrot and stick with you? And just gave you something and said, oh, I'm going to take it back. That's not the kind of a God we serve. He's never blessed us because we've earned it or we deserve it or we merit it. We don't. It makes me angry when people misrepresent his character and his nature. So because of people like that, all the time, we hear people say all they want is your money. That's all they care about. They don't care about you, they just want your money. That's why here at Calvary Chapel, we never have pledge drives. We never make appeals for offerings. Nothing more is ever said that than, you know, you can just drop your tithes and offerings in the agape box in the hallway. It's up to you whether you give or not. No one's going to ask you to give. Now, I feel that it is criminal and manifestly wrong for these ministers to constantly beg people for money. It's almost as bad as the era in the Roman church when they sold indulgences. You go back in church history, which is a sad and checkered story. They used to actually sell indulgences. What does that mean? You want to get your prayer answered? Send in your offering. You've got an unsaved son? Send your offering to us and God will save him. You can buy salvation for your son. You can buy healing for your mother. You can buy all kinds of indulgences. It's made out to be this way in these phony fundraising drives. Now, if the people soliciting these funds lived very simple lives, if they didn't live these lavish lifestyles, then maybe I could accept it more. But when these same people who are begging poor little widows to sacrifice from their social security checks to send money into them, and they themselves are living very high lifestyles, I find it absolutely intolerable. It's nothing more than fleecing the flock. And I don't like it one little bit. And it's Acts chapter 8. You'll find the story of a sorcerer named Simon. And when Simon saw that the Holy Spirit was given through the laying on of the apostles' hands, He offered them money to give him the power to bestow the Holy Spirit upon anyone on whom he laid his hands. But Peter said to him, "Your money perish with you, because you thought that the gift of God could be purchased with money. You have neither part nor portion in this matter, for your heart is not right in the sight of God. Repent, therefore, of this your wickedness, and pray God if perhaps the thought of your heart may be forgiven you." You can read about that in Acts chapter 8. You have to admire Paul's heart. He wasn't out to seek personal enrichment. He was only concerned with how he might more effectively spread the gospel. That was his driving influence. Verse 16 of 1 Corinthians chapter 9 says, "For if I preach the gospel, I have nothing to boast of, for necessity is laid upon me. Yes, woe to me if I do not, woe is me, I should say, if I do not preach the gospel." Paul says, "I don't glory in the fact that I let go of my right to be supported in order that I might preach to you. For I have no other choice but to preach." Jeremiah chapter 20, verse 9 says, "Then I said, I will not make mention of him, nor speak any more in his name. But his word was in my heart like a burning fire shut up in my bones. I was weary of holding it back, and I could not." From his dungeon cell, Jeremiah cried, "I'm tired of speaking in the name of the Lord. No one is listening to me. People are mad at me. Some are even trying to kill me. I'm going to speak no more." That's what he said, until he realized that the word of God was like fire in his bones and he could not keep quiet. That's what happens in ministry, isn't it? You just can't keep God's word to yourself. Verse 17, "For if I do this willingly, I have a reward. But if against my will, I have been entrusted with a stewardship." Paul says, "Woe is me if I don't preach. If I do it willingly, I'll have a reward. But even if I do it because I have no other choice, the gospel has been entrusted to me." Paul recognized the value and the importance of the priceless treasure that had been entrusted to him. And we'll see that again in 2 Corinthians chapter 4 when we get there. The scripture says that God has entrusted priceless treasure. He's placed it in earthen vessels. That's you. That's me. We're the earthen vessels. And he's placed this most priceless treasure in every one of us who name the name of Jesus Christ. It's priceless treasure. But God doesn't like us to just hold treasure in and keep it to ourselves. He wants us to share it. Verse 18, "What is my reward then? That when I preach the gospel, I may present the gospel of Christ without charge, that I may not abuse my authority in the gospel." So Paul declares, "I'm not going to charge for the gospel. I'm not going to lay a burden on people. I'm not going to play games with people. I'm not going to present fundraising gimmicks to people." Verse 19 begins, "For though I am free from all men," in other words, "I didn't owe you anything, and I haven't taken anything from you, so I am free of all men." There are a lot of politicians out there who could learn a few lessons from that verse. Verse 19 continues, "I have made myself a servant to all that I might win the more." I'm really free from you. But I made myself a servant that I might gain more to Christ. Verse 20, "And to the Jews I became as a Jew, that I might win Jews. To those who are under the law, as under the law, that I might win those who are under the law. To those who are without law, as without law, not being without law toward God, but under law toward Christ, that I might win those who are without law. To the weak, I became as weak, that I might win the weak. I have become all things to all men, that I might by all means save some. Now I do this for the gospel's sake, that I may be partaker of it with you. So Paul is seeking to identify with people. He's relating to the people to whom he ministers. He isn't setting himself above people, nor is he preaching down to them. He comes down on their level. He seeks to understand where they are, seeking to identify with them in such a way that they could identify with Paul, so that he could lead them to the strength and the power that they might know through Jesus Christ. Verse 24, do you not know that those who run in a race all run, but I receive the prize? But one receives the prize. So, here's why I let go of my liberty, declares Paul. I understand the big picture of eternity. Paul knew that heaven was real. How do you know that? Well, at one point in his ministry, he was left for dead outside the city of Lystra. You can read about that in Acts chapter 14. And Paul was caught up into the third heaven. Paul describes that experience in 2 Corinthians chapter 12. And he says, whether or not I was in the spirit or actually transported physically, I don't really know. He said, but somehow I was there. And what I saw was so amazing that I can't even speak about it. It wouldn't be lawful. I couldn't even describe it to you. Because he had a sneak preview of coming attractions, Paul set his sight on winning the prize. Verse 24 continues, run in such a way that you may obtain it. So life is as a race. Paul says, run to win. I like that. I have enough competitive spirit in me that I don't play to lose. Whenever I go out in any sport, I go out to win. Paul said to be that way in your life for Christ. Go all out, so run that you might obtain the prize. You might think, well, I'm not Paul. Fair enough. You might think that there's no use running a race in which spiritual giants like Paul are sure to lap you time and again. Understand this. We're not competing against any other brother or sister. Did you get that? Let's say it again. We're not competing against any other brother or sister. We're competing against ourselves. Jesus makes this very clear in his teachings on the talents in Matthew chapter 25, and his teaching on the minas in Luke chapter 19. Is that which the Lord has uniquely entrusted to you being developed for his glory? Are you laying down your rights and your privileges to see others brought into the kingdom? That's the nature of the race we run. Leave it all on the field. I've had coaches tell me that. Leave it all on the field. That means give it everything you got. So run that you might obtain the prize. Verse 25. And everyone who competes for the prize is temperate or exercises self-control in all things. Now they do it to obtain a perishable crown, but we for an imperishable. Still speaking of sports, Paul changes his metaphor from that of a race to that of a wrestling match. And of course, the Olympics were held in Athens, the ancient Olympics. But the second largest athletic events in the world, the Isthmus Games, were held in Corinth. So the people of Corinth knew a lot about wrestling matches and running races. They watched as athletes would arrive a year before the games to train single-mindedly to win the prize. And what was the sought-after prize? What was it they were working so hard to achieve, spend all those hours training for? It was a small laurel wreath to put on one's head. That was the prize. A little wreath that would, sooner rather than later, fade fall apart. Paul says, look at what these athletes do to win a simple crown of leaves. The crown for which you race is incorruptible. It will last forever. And you say, so what? If you looked in my closet, you wouldn't find a single crown. I'm just not into crowns. Oh, really? Well, the crown that Paul refers to here is one of five types of crown that is identified in Scripture. This one is linked to a declaration in Proverbs chapter 11, verse 30. He who wins souls is wise. It's also linked to Daniel's statement that those who turn many to righteousness will shine like the stars forever and ever. That's from Daniel chapter 12. That's fine, but what does it have to do with me? To those of us who are more concerned about seeing people saved than our own pleasure, our own ease, our own liberty, a crown will be given. This will not just be an ornament for you to wear on your head. In light of 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 41 and 42, this is going to determine your function and your capacity to enjoy eternity. What do you mean? Well, you see, while everyone in heaven is going to be completely happy and totally joyful, as we read in Psalm 16, the crowns that we win on earth will have a direct link to our function and our capacity to enjoy eternity. And I'll give you an illustration. Let's say you're a kindergarten student. Some of you might be able to remember back that far and relate to this. Let's say you're a kindergarten student and your teacher appoints you as the chair monitor. Anybody ever been appointed as the chair monitor? Okay, some of you maybe. This chair monitor, you have significant responsibilities, right? You have to make sure that all the chairs are properly slid under the tables when the bell rings. That's exciting stuff to a young kid. Now, if I, as an adult, was appointed chair monitor, I wouldn't be too excited about that. I wouldn't jump up and down and say, I can't wait to tell my wife, Karen. You see, for me, the position of chair monitor no longer carries the same impact, because at this point, my capacity, my understanding, my involvement with life, it's bigger than that. In the same way, Jesus told us that in heaven, some will rule over 10 cities, some will rule over 5 cities or 1 city, and some will be chair monitors. Paul understood this. He knew that a crown is not a fashion statement. It's an indication of what we're going to be doing for the next zillion years. What if we, like Paul, really believed that? I guarantee that every one of us would be looking for opportunities to be stepped on if it meant that the person for whom we laid down our rights would see something of Jesus or come into a saving knowledge of him. What you do with your life is so important. Don't bury your talents. Don't waste your time. Don't foolishly fritter away your resources and your money. Run to win the prize. Verse 26, therefore I run thus, not with uncertainty. Thus I fight, not as one who beats the air, but I discipline my body. This last phrase would be more correctly translated, I keep my body under. Before you were saved, your body was not under. Your body was on top. That is, your flesh governed your soul, your mind, and your emotions. It also governed your spirit, the real you that lives forever. To see how true this is, all you have to do is listen to the conversations that take place, you know, at work or on your campus. Where you're here, you know, you're going to hear the average person talk about his body, about his financial concerns, recreational pursuits, occupational goals, physical needs. But when the natural man gets saved, suddenly everything is different. The flesh no longer dominates him. The spirit is now on top. Suddenly there's peace in his heart, and life makes sense. Now, because the flesh hates being in the basement, as time goes by, it demands to be on top again. And when it is, the new believer's life is a mess. For to be carnally minded is death, as we read in Romans chapter 8, verse 6. So he eventually gets to the place where he says, "Lord, forgive me, I've given in to the flesh again." He confesses his sin, turns his life back over to God, and his body is under once more. Does this war have to go on daily, hourly, constantly? Paul gives us the key. I keep my body under. I will not allow my body to determine what I watch, what I read, what I listen to, what I think about. I will keep my body in the basement. How can this be accomplished, you ask? Well, let me suggest to you one very practical way. One that we tend not to practice too often. How long has it been since you said no to your stomach? How long has it been since you've said, I'm going to use the hour that I would have spent feeding my growling, demanding stomach in order to pull away, pray for my family, for the community, and for myself? I find it interesting that Jesus did not say, if you fast, but when you fast. See Matthew chapter 6. In other words, the assumption is that we will fast. When you regularly say no to your stomach, you'll be amazed how much easier it will be to say no to the other temptations that plague you. Fasting from food is only one of the many disciplines that the Bible teaches us. Another is saying no when your body tells you to hit the snooze button again. It's saying, see, body, you're under. You're not ruling me. I'm out of bed. I'm on my knees. I'm in the Word. It's following Jesus' example. He rose a great while before morning to seek his Father. I keep my body under, Paul says. I'm tired of my body ruling me and the death it inevitably brings. Therefore, my spirit, ruled by God's spirit, will be that which controls my soul, my will, my personality, my emotions. Verse 27 concludes, and bring it into subjection, lest when I have preached to others, I myself should become disqualified. To bring it into subjection literally means to lead about as a slave. Paul made sure that his body was the servant and his inner man was the master. The desires of his body were not going to rule over his entire self. Paul is saying, I let go of my liberty that I might win people to Jesus Christ. Why? Because I'm running a race. I'm in a race for a prize that will affect who I am and what I do in the ages to come. Therefore, though I'm free to do all things, I can be disqualified if I don't keep my flesh under control, if I cause another to stumble. And you'll never regret knocking fleshly pursuits out of your life. Within each of us, there's a battle raging. We must discipline ourselves to keep the body under. I promise you, you'll never regret letting go of the things that, you know, would have tripped others and disqualified you. Those things that would have wiped out your spiritual stamina and affected your endurance. Are you as disciplined in your spiritual life today as you were a year ago? Or has your appreciation for the finished work of the cross and your understanding that your salvation is secure apart from anything you do or don't do, because that skewed your thinking? Yes, you're free. But have you used that liberty in a way that's tripping others and disqualifying yourself? Use your liberty wisely, my friends. Keep your body under, for to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded brings abundant life and perfect peace. Next week, we're going to be studying chapter 10, so read ahead. And don't forget, next Sunday is Operation Christmas Child Collection Sunday. Let's close in prayer, shall we? Father, how grateful we are for the hope, the solace, the comfort that we find in your word. We have the absolute expectation of coming good, because that is your character. That is your nature. That is your heart for your people. To bless us. You are not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. How we love you this morning, Lord. How we thank you for the blessings that you have showered upon us. And now, Lord, help us to take those blessings and not just bury them deep within ourselves, but share them with the people you would cause to cross our paths. We love you, Lord. Thank you for this day. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Lord Jesus, and give us that joy, that victory. And Lord, we just lift this week up to you, Lord. Help us to go out in victory in your presence, Lord. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. And now may the Lord bless you. May he pour out his spirit upon you and use you as a vessel to pour out his spirit upon all flesh. May he empower you. May he equip you. May he strengthen you. May he encourage you. May he make you all that he has set you apart to be. May he conform you to his image, the image of his firstborn son. May he cause you to take the priceless treasure that he has placed within you and use it to further and expand his kingdom. And may he cause you to know the depth, the riches, the height, the breadth, the width of his love for you, which we can never fully know or appreciate this side of heaven. But may he just increase your understanding of that. The Lord bless thee.
The Lord bless thee.
And keep thee.
And keep thee.
The Lord make
his face to shine upon thee, and be gracious unto thee, and be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift up his countenance upon thee and give thee peace.
May God richly bless you.